back to Proactive, and I'm joined now by Jonathan Satchell, who is the Chief Executive at the Learning Technologies Group. So firstly, Jonathan, a very warm welcome to you. How are you doing?
Yeah, good, thank you. Good to see you. Thanks
for having me. It's great to have you back on. And last time we spoke, we were talking about your trading update for 2022, and you couldn't be too specific with the numbers because the year had just ended. But now we have the full year results, and 2022 really was the year in which you integrated GP strategies, wasn't it?
Absolutely. Well, really, it was the, we commercially transformed GP. And when I say we also need to very much respect and appreciate the fantastic efforts that the GP leadership team and their colleagues achieved. It really was a big story. I think a lot of investors, when they supported us in the placing in summer of 21 to make this acquisition, were hopeful, but naturally a little bit skeptical about whether we would achieve it. And we achieved everything we predicted, plus probably ahead of ourselves by about 1%. So yeah, the business achieved a 12.7% margin across the year, exit run rate of 14%. And bear in mind, prior to our ownership, it was delivering 5% EBIT margin. So pretty impressive. But actually, that hides the really big story, because when you go through those sort of transformation programs, naturally you have a tendency to disrupt and distract people while you're doing it. That's natural. But what really surprised me and gave me a lot of comfort about the resilience of this business is that it still achieved a 6% organic constant currency revenue growth across the year over year, despite the transformation we were putting it through. I think that really points to the resilience.
All understood, Jonathan. Well, it isn't the only part of the business, of course, so perhaps you can explain what else has been going on.
Absolutely. So the original LTG, which comprised of a number of software businesses, still a substantial business, incidentally, performed robustly during the year. As most investors know, we have a business called PeopleFluent, which we bought in 2018, which had a declining revenue profile when we bought it. It continued to decline in line with our expectations by about 10%. But if you extract that and don't let it distort the other numbers, we enjoyed organic constant currency growth of about 12% across our other businesses, our software businesses, which we were very pleased with. Some standout performers were Rusty and Watershed, and we remain very confident about the prospect for our SaaS businesses in this coming year.
So plenty of cheerful numbers for people to look at. You know, it's overall an upbeat announcement, but there is a phrase in there about the macro environment, which gives the sense of wanting to manage expectations for calendar year 23. So what's your take there?
Yeah, I can give you a great deal of color and candor on this. As a business, I'm very proud of our track record in 9 years of being a public company, that we have always achieved or beaten consensus expectations, particularly for EBIT. I think it was 1 year we came in just on the line for revenue. And we want to continue that track record of delivering. And we felt that £115 million consensus for absolute EBIT was at the top end rather than the middle of the range for where we thought that the business would achieve this year. So yes, we downgraded that or adjusted guidance to the lower end of the range for about £110 million. People seem disappointed by that. I still think that growing 9% from £101 million last year to £110 would be an exceptional achievement in what is a challenging macroeconomic environment. That's EBIT. We would also grow revenue quite significantly as well. We're confident about that. You know, this is not the beginning of a series of adjusting numbers. It is just that what we've seen in the business and the environment suggests that that's the appropriate profit number to aim for. And I certainly hope that we will be delivering on or ahead of expectations at the end of the year.
And Jonathan, one of the macro challenges is the prospect of, or indeed already having, high interest rates. So how are you looking from a leverage point of view?
Well, leverage has come down very dramatically, and I have to say I'm pretty comfortable it has. I wouldn't want to be sitting at that we knew it was temporary, in fairness. We didn't get ourselves out of shape here, but we were 1.8 times net debt to EBITDA at the end of 21. And I'm proud to say we came down to 1.1 times at the end of 22. And that was also against the headwinds of a stronger dollar, which meant that our translation to sterling, when we translate the big loan that we have in dollars, was of course a much bigger sterling number. So all in all, a very creditable performance on cash generation and debt management, and I expect substantial further progress this year. But also, we may well choose to exercise our balance sheet a little and actually borrow a little more based on making some acquisitions, because we are very much now, having settled GP in, we are back on the acquisition trail, but not chasing valuations, because I still think that there is a disparity between private company valuations and public company valuations, which seem to have got, should we say, a slightly different rating these days.
All right. So plenty for us to be keeping an eye on there, Jonathan, and hopefully it won't be long before we get another update from you. But until then, thank you very much for your time.
Good to talk to you. Thanks.